How many guitar players know the brand Squire? When I say that name, how many memories are dredged up of your first guitar, maybe both good and bad? I would venture to guess a whole lot. Why? Well, for the past 40 years or so, Squire has been known as the subsidiary brand of Fender Instruments, making copies of their famous big brothers at a fraction of the price. As a result, many guitar players probably bought their first Strat or Tele under the Squire name. But I thought it would be fun to look at the history of this company, which I found out was a lot older and had a much more rich history than you might have thought. So let's take a look at the surprising history of Squire Guitars next on the Guitar Historian Channel. Hello, fellow rock history lovers, and welcome to the Guitar Historian Channel. Today, I thought it would be fun to do a one-off video on a guitar brand that is often shrouded in mystery and confusion, and one that often gets a bad rep due to their cheaper price points. Of course, I'm talking about the ultimate first guitar brand, Squire Guitars, which has been making officially licensed copies of Fender guitars since 1982. But the history of the company actually goes all the way back to the 19th century, so I'm pretty sure this retrospective will surprise many viewers out there. But before we get started, make sure you subscribe to the Guitar Historian Channel, where we examine everything and everyone under the umbrella of classic rock and blues, gear, musicians, and moments in rock history. If that sounds like something you'd like to be a part of, hit the bell icon to get notified whenever we post new content as well. Now, let's go all the way back to the late 1800s and examine the very beginnings of the Squire Instrument Company. Jerome Bonaparte Squire was an English immigrant instrument maker who emigrated to Battle Creek, Michigan sometime in the late 19th century, but he moved to Boston, Massachusetts in 1881 to open up a repair and building shop. Squire was known for his extremely fine work throughout the mid to late 1800s, even earning the nickname the American Stradivarius. High praise indeed. Squire became known for naming his instruments after famous historical figures, such as a run of 12 violins that were named after the apostles, and some named after American figures such as George Washington. He made his own lustrous brown varnish for the instruments, and they were known for their bright, clear sound. Today, some of his works are even valued at over $100,000 and are still played in orchestras around the country. Squire's son, named Victor Carroll Squire, worked in his father's workshop for many years, but the time came in 1890 when Victor felt it was time to leave his father's shadow and start his own business in the music industry. In 1890, Victor would move back to Battle Creek to start his own business, naming it VC Squire Company, which focused on marketing the instruments made in Michigan to schools and famous violinists throughout America. This helped his business grow steadily through the rest of the century, but after the calendar turned to 1900, Squire had an idea. He noted that most of the finest instrument strings were produced in Europe, and so most of the top violin, banjo, and other stringed instrument players in America had to import the strings at a very high cost, often forcing them to use strings well past their prime. Victor began making hand-wound strings in the United States, creating instant demand and massive influx of orders that would overwhelm him and his team. So, Squire devised a machine converted from a treadle sewing machine into a string winder, which would produce up to 1,000 uniformly wound strings per day. The demand for Squire's American-made and more cheaply procured strings exploded over the next few years, and Squire's company grew expansively, supplying strings across the country for stringed instruments, pianos, and even entering into the business of making radios, records, and some instruments. The company would continue as a top supplier of instrument strings over the next several decades, continuing into the guitar revolution of the 1950s, where our story first intersects with the Fender Instrument Company. As Leo Fender was creating his first solid body instruments, his main supplier of strings was the Squire Company. As the Fender Company became one of the most popular electric instrument makers through the late 50s and early 60s, Squire continued to be a major supplier of strings on the new instruments, and by 1963, they would be designated as the official supplier of strings on all Fender guitars and basses. Fender continued to achieve massive growth and would acquire Squire officially in 1965, but within weeks of this acquisition, Leo began experiencing health problems and would swiftly sell his company to CBS, who picked Squire up as well at this time. Although CBS made many sweeping changes at the parent company of Fender, the Squire String Company came out of the deal largely intact and unscathed. They would continue to make strings for Fender, but in the mid-70s, the strings would be rebranded to the Fender name, and the Squire name would be retired for what most thought would be forever. Throughout the rest of the 70s, most American guitar brands were fighting one of the same enemies that the country had fought in World War II, Japan. Japanese companies like Tokai, Greco, and Ibanez were making faithful and high-quality copies of Fender and Gibson guitars. And these guitars were cutting seriously into sales, especially in Europe, even making their way over to the States from time to time. Fender would start to formulate a plan to combat the blatant copying, filing a number of lawsuits, as did Gibson. This ushered in the nickname of the lawsuit guitars, which are still very sought after by collectors today, sometimes matching the quality and sound of their much more expensive brothers by Gibson and Fender. Fender's first strategy was to simply enter the Japanese market by buying Japanese guitar makers Yamano Gaki and Kanda Shokai, creating Fender Japan Limited, and reissuing a number of instruments in Japan. In Europe, however, Fender needed to stem the tide of copies still flowing out of Japan, but they didn't want to dilute the American or Japanese instruments and the Fender name. This was when the Squire name was reborn. After some false starts, Fender would acquire the Fujigen Gaki factory in Matsumoto, Nagano Prefecture, and begin production. Fender began to market the same Japanese-built, high-quality instruments in Europe under what they called the Squire series. Initially, the guitars sported a full Fender logo with a small decal in the upper portion of the headstock that read Squire series. However, this was deemed to be too confusing against the American-made and much more expensive models, and so for 1983, the Squire name appeared in Fender's place with a small By Fender underneath the Squire nameplate. Later that same year, Squires also started to appear as officially licensed, cheaper versions of their Fender counterparts in the United States as well. Initially, the Japanese instruments used many American-made hardware pieces and pickups, but as production more firmly transitioned to Japan, less and less of the American-made parts were being used. It's not exactly known as to why Fender chose to use the Squire brand name for the line of guitars. A good bet is that since Fender already owned the name Squire, they felt it would be a cheap option. But another thought is that the term Squire, spelled with an R-E at the end rather than the E-R of Jerome Squire's English last name, is also a term used as the assistant to the medieval knight, and perhaps someone at Fender liked the play on words that the brand would represent. Whatever the reason, Squire guitars became a huge part of the Fender stable after 1983, when the Squire branded guitars and basses became the official copies of Fender musical instruments. In the mid-1980s, Fender was bought from CBS by the last CBS-era president, William Schultz, along with several business partners and employees from Fender itself. Fender's original Fullerton factory wasn't included in the sale, and so for almost a year in 1985, only Japanese Fenders were made while they built a new American factory in Corona, California, where it still resides. Squire kept right on going through all the tumult, continuing to supply the new and armchair guitarists of the world with cheaper copies from Japan. Eventually, Squire's factories would be moved to Korea and finally Indonesia and China to continue the low price points that consumers expected from the Fender copies. In today's market, Squire occupies a well-loved place among guitar fans. Over the last 10 to 15 years, the brand seems to have taken an especially keen eye to quality and playability, and the guitars that Squire has been producing are of a quality that rivals many guitars costing twice as much. Squire's Classic Vibe series, copying the vintage accoutrements of various eras of Fender instrument development, has been especially popular and is often cited as a top buy for new guitarists and those looking for an entry-level guitar of higher quality. I own two myself, the 50s Classic Vibe Esquire and the 70s Classic Vibe Telecaster Deluxe. Great guitars with great necks. Squire had a lot of fun over the past few years, issuing a number of their own ideas and even acting as a springboard to models that would eventually go on to be adopted by its parent company. The Squire Pawn Shop series emerged in the mid-2000s, featuring mashups of several Fender models such as Strats with Tele pickup configurations and vice versa, or guitars modeled to look older but with newer pickup configurations. This morphed into the more recent Paranormal series, which featured such hits as the Jaguar with a Tele pickup configuration and the Toronado, which looks like a Jazzmaster but has two PAF-style humbuckers. Squire sure has had an incredible ride. A company that started way back in the 19th century has become one of the most enduring nameplates in musical instrument history. I'm sure when Jerome Squire was making violins in Boston back in the 1880s, he couldn't have ever envisioned what the company would become later, making rock machines for millions of guitars on a budget while retaining a lot of the quality and playability of his much more expensive brothers over at Fender. And I was right, this was a fun look at some guitar history. If you like docs like this, remember to subscribe to the Guitar Historian channel and drop a like on the video to let YouTube know that you think other guitar fans would like to see this video. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.